Welcome, gratitude. Thank you for taking the time to being here. Thank you for being here as presence. Consciousness, Sutra 87. Empowered transformations. The difference between a person who has not yet woken up and a person who has woken up is much like being a mouse, the rat race, running around like rats, or a choice to be the eagle, gliding through thought, gliding through realities, gliding through states of consciousness, expanding it further and further. Each of us here today are here only because we seek. There are the three most powerful boons, blessings we could receive in a lifetime. The first, the urge to seek, the urge to want to connect to Source. The second, attaining the Guru. When we say the Guru could be in the form of human, in the form of being you. If you read a book like the Bible, there's the Guru of Christ behind the Bible. Likewise, the Gurus could be in every form. Any which way that opens the door to Source is the Guru. And the third, to be awake to our own inner Guru. So my journey began first with the Goddess. And there was urge to connect to the Goddess for many reasons. The first is when we are trampled in our life, when we are on the lows of our life, and at that point in time we are crying to God, God, why me? And then we just go to temples, churches, we go to all the sacred places, we meditate, we go to meet all the higher conscious beings. The first reason why we might want to go is to resolve that pain, to resolve the problems we have in life. That's the first. So when we begin our journey by seeking the divine, our journey has started. And when our journey has started, we have started like a sadhu, on one side like a recluse. We are willing to give, to learn. We are willing to let go, to learn. And as we go deeper into the fires of seeking the divinity could be sought in so many forms, so many different ways. The reason why church, temples, mosque, and all these sacred places exist is so we can go and step into the pre-existing vortex of energy to seek. And initially our prayers are definitely, it begins with where we are at, the human realities, maybe even seeking the divine's help to get a job, to all the mundane requirements we seek as prayers. And these prayers are definitely heard. It's the door opening for us to begin a relationship with the divine. That's the first step, the seeking. Then comes understanding that we need something beyond that. And the seeking is no more outside ourselves as much as it is inside ourselves. It's lighting a lamp inside ourselves and growing that fire, we begin to know that that needs be done. And this in a way sets us on a journey to call for the divine to come to us more in tangible forms, to come to us more in the form of the human, come to us more in the form that can actually be with us at all times. And in my journey, I was lucky to have been taken through my death experience by Bhairava Sekaswami. And through that experience, I was given a lingam to bring focus and celebrate. The states of joy were so powerful that I wanted it at all times. And that got me started in the Siva Linga Puja and into my journey. Into my journey of wanting more and more and more of bliss to feel becoming the bliss form. And then in my journey was when my reality that I knew disappeared. Now there was another reality altogether. This was at this point, this other reality was the vastness of whom I was, devoid of the karmic shapes and forms, like my businesses had collapsed. Everything that I held clear dissolved away, allowing the vast space to grow. And here was when Sadhu Krishnaveni Amma, a sage who was meditating in a cave for 65 years, when she called me and said, "Bring the lingam, I need it." And when I took it to her, that's when she starts crying, saying, "Lord Shiva had told me you needed a lingam. Told me that I needed a lingam, and that lingam needs to come from Sri Kalahasti." And at that time she asked Shiva, he said, told Lord Shiva, "At this age, how do you expect me to go and get a lingam?" And Lord Shiva told her, "I will bring it to you." That's the same time, same moment when she had actually come in my dream, my meditation, sorry, to say, "Bring the lingam." So when I brought the lingam to her in the physical, her meditative mind and my meditative mind came together as one. Then the next guru was Siddha Rajasami, who opened the door of the Siddha wisdom and opened the door of the grace of Siddha wisdom through the mantras and through the teachings. Likewise was Mahasava Swami, who lived in the forest, who taught the breath and the journey beyond consciousness. And Guru Ayya, who was in a meditative state for 18 years, he came down the mountain and then he's now back in meditation in his village. So when you say meditation, what it means is one single focus of the mind that is held for days, months and years. And this is consciousness, this is grace, the grace of the gurus. So the gurus' blessing is to alight your lamp so you can be one with source. In our pathway of the Siddhas, our teaching in essence is realities when the seeker attains mastery. In other words, we are here to liberate each other to source by alighting the innermost lamp. And in understanding that we have that inner lamp lit, we grow the fire to be the masters, to connect to our own innate, pristine, innermost wisdom that is perfect, that is the scriptures. This is mastery of consciousness. And Sutra number 87 mentions about how the seeking, in the seeking, we slowly go more towards the source and build an intimate relationship with the source, and ultimately and finally we become the source presence itself. And as we become the source presence, we begin to realize that now slowly we become like a sparrow flying. And slowly with our knowing, we utilize consciousness as tools to enhance ourselves further, to become like the crow flying a little bit more effortlessly. And then we climb into being the eagle-like state. When we say empowerment, the empowerment is beautiful, because when you watch the movie Matrix, we understand that that is whom we are when we are in a meditative state, an eagle-like mind, able to condense 1 month's work into a few hours. We are able to transcend time by going into the timeless states of joy and redefine time as in aligning that intent into the human realities. That is empowerment. Empowerment is also the ability of each of us to question, ask. It is important in our journey to throw away anything called belief systems that does not serve us. For instance, we might want to justify the act of killing an animal and eating it out of hunger. But when you realize that you are awake and the soul that you have is one and the same with the animal, would you hurt it? If a scripture says it's okay, you can hurt it. It's okay to eat non-vegetarianism. Then the question is, where are you? Where we are at is our own heart speaks. We know our heart's language of truth, and this language of truth is empowerment. We know our truth. We know what's good enough for us. This is why the yogis call the mind that is empowered, a yogic mind, the mind of a swan. A swan-like mind is able to fly over the Himalayas quite effortlessly. The Himalayas, the mountains, are the karmic impediments. All of us, in some way or the other, are caught in our own karmic impediments. The yogi has the ability to transmute and change that karma which is limiting us into that which is dharma. For instance, just imagine this. We are taking a walk on the foothills of the mountain and looking at the mountain. The mountain looks big, and at the foothills, that is when we are looking at a mundane job, we are looking at it from a perspective of seeing ourselves like a piece in the chessboard. But imagine yourself having climbed up a mountain and you're seeing the scenery, and the scenery is so beautiful, and that scenery is every part of our life. We are seeing it with detachment, we are seeing it from the grander scale. Now you're seeing like a whole chessboard, and you know where to move what thought to take and what thought to discourage. Understanding where you want the thought from makes a lot of difference. Understanding that you are the states of joy, and that state of joy is like being on the peak of a mountain. You have the ability to choose which thought is aligned to you, your frequency and which reality you want. So from above, sitting above, we are able now to create potency of each thought by way of climbing up to the highest place to choose the highest thought. And from here, manifesting that thought is very much as having come into clarity. You have come into absolute clarity as to seeing the big picture. Now, will we be discouraged by failures? No. We would take every failure of ours as a solution, a prayer for solution needed, and that prayer will be answered. This is the states of grace in our journey. We do see hundreds of impediments, but when we climb up, up above the mind, up above to be the eagle-like perception of wisdom, now when we look at what problems we have, we see it merely like mountains that needs to be glided over. Problems are going to be there at all times. But now we begin to enjoying ourselves doing what we are doing. That is simply gliding, simply enjoying our state of being. At the same time, because we know we are doers, and in our doing, we are inspired, and that inspiration fire makes us the eagles. So, to begin with, into this journey of awakening ourselves to being whom we are, the first and foremost important thing for ourselves to do is light our inner lamp and begin a daily journey. And a daily journey begins to become, or does become, a journey of every breath in awareness. Through breath, the mind behaves. So, when you put a mantra alongside the breath, the mind converges, and now the inner fire is lit. The inner fire is the energy field that begins to invoke, that invokes all the grace that is impregnated within the mantra. For instance, the Siddha mantras come from our ancient lineage of light. When you're invoking, when you're utilizing the Siddha mantras, you are bringing into your presence the grace of the ancient lineage of light. To receive the mantra itself is grace. We go back to the story of Kabir, who was found in the forest, brought up as a Muslim. He was awake. He knew he needed a guru. And he also knew he needed a guru from a being who, though was intellectually a giant, this guru was notably an advanced soul. So what Kabir did was to obtain the mantra from this guru. He laid down on the walkway to the pond where the guru would wake up early in the morning before the sun came up, and he would walk to get to pick up water for his celebrations, the puja, in the morning. And Kabir knew that if he positioned his body on the stairways down to the pond, this guru is not going to see him and is going to step on him. And that's what he did. And when the guru stepped on him, the guru said, Rama, 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 Rama. And Kabir took that to be his mantra. And he utilized this mantra to grow and grow and grow the inner fire to the place and point where when Kabir said, Rama, 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 he could bring people alive. Years later, he mentioned, my guru is this being, this master. And the master gets back saying, hey, tell me about it. I'm not aware. And then Kabir says, you know, this is what I did to obtain the mantra from you. And the master understands the greatness of Kabir because a being of consciousness knows how to obtain the tools of consciousness, and getting a mantra, receiving a mantra, an ancient lineage mantra, is the first powerful step to empowerment. Beings like Aya would impart his mantra more as a grace connect to anyone who came to seek him. So all you had to do was recite his mantra, and then his followers would mention, you don't have to disturb Aya. Aya is not going to call you inside, and you are not wanting to go. You should not go inside to disturb Aya. Go home with the mantra, you have him. Go home with the mantra, you have his presence, you have his grace, you have his blessings, and anything that you desire will come true. Tell Aya what you want through as you recite the mantra, and it will come true. This is the power of the Siddha mantras. So, the first, obtain powerful mantras or mantra and delve into it. Feel it like the innermost fire and grow this fire and grow this fire and grow this fire, and understand our mind coming to the single pointedness can take us beyond the mind, can take us to the place where we are the spirit having the human experience, and the human experience is the mind, and the spiritual experience is higher consciousness. Ramana Maharishi, one of the great sages of his times, he was the founder to what we are witnessing now. Paramahamsa Yogananda did his job of awakening humanity by coming to the West. Ramana Maharishi didn't move. He stayed in one place. And whoever came near him were enlightened. So Ramana Maharishi had the story about the three thieves. The first thief was not only vicious, angry, violent, he was also lazy and sleepy. The second thief was active. He was basically a good guy, but he was never still. He would always be moving around and setting himself into constant action. And the third thief was a good guy who believed in good, but he was by circumstance a thief. A visitor goes to the forest, and that visitor, that seeker you could say, gets caught by the three thieves, and the three thieves tie him up, and he says, help, help. And the good thief, the third thief, says, let him go, why do we hold him, why are we keeping him? And the other two thieves mention, he deserves to be tied up. Let's keep him tied. So one day when the violent bad thief took a walk around, and the second thief had been walking around the place, the third thief, the good thief, comes and unties this visitor, to the forest and says, "Go, you're free now. Step outside the forest. You are now the knower. Step out. You are now the human who is destined to understand himself by stepping outside. Step out." And when he steps out, this being understands that the first thief was tamas. Tamas is that streak that every one of us have. We are born with it. And in our awareness, we wake up and we are able to get over it. Tamas means all the nature we would not want. Anger, jealousy, ego, pride, laziness. The second thief is rajasic, action, the rat race. Most of us understand each day as just action and going around and restlessness. And the third thief is sattvic. Sattvic is the sage. The sage-like mind, calm, good, but still caught in the circumstances of the forest. And the forest represents the mind. The forest represents karma. The forest represents the circumstances of karma. The moment we step out of the forest, now we know whom we are. We are the spirit. I am. This I am experience is how we would want to meditate and pray. Very easily we are led to understanding and realizing the I am as consciousness. Through my journeys as a yogi, the question I had to ask realized beings was, when I meditate into the depth of depth, what is my experience going to be? I was expecting golden light. I was expecting amazing descriptions that I hope to hear. I was told, ultimately, you'll reach a place of void. And that void is your own awareness of the expansiveness of nothingness. And inside that, you will understand a dance. And that dance is your awareness in states of perpetuality of joy. In understanding this of consciousness sutra, as empowered thought, we begin to realize we are the source energy. When we say we are the source and we are the soul force, we come into saying, or come into understanding whom we really are. Now, this is a story of Mahatma Gandhi. See, freedom for India did not come that easily. When Mahatma Gandhi first advocated non-violence, of course, it immediately went to the heart of most of India who could understand Mahatma Gandhi. But this was an untried concept. This Mahimsa and the principles that Mahatma Gandhi was using as Satyagraha was not yet tried and tested. So when he began his movement, he had a lot of faith in the British government, thinking, these are good guys and they will realize what I'm doing and they will definitely be good to the country they are in, because in India, any guest is considered to be God. So when the British came, they were actually welcomed. So whoever landed on the Indian shore was welcomed as God. And when they took over India, it was a little bit of a state of shock for India to watch it happen. So when Mahatma Gandhi put his heart and soul after coming to India from South Africa, he was met with a lot of resistance. There was a point in time when he went into the political wilderness. Over 15 years of wilderness. The freedom movement for all purposes had come to a halt. At that point in time, they asked Ramana Maharishi, the sage who was in Tiruvannamalai, to tell us about Gandhi. At that time, he had not yet earned the name Mahatma. He was not given the name Mahatma. So, what Ramana Maharishi has to say gives us an understanding of whom we really can be. Ramana Maharishi said, this person Gandhi has been gifted with a soul force, Atma Sakti, the power of the soul, the awake being. No matter what, he will accomplish his goals. Now, we all know India attained its freedom thanks much in part to the non-violent movement of Mahatma Gandhi. But beyond that is, you see, India today, the reason why it had not blown up like Pakistan or has not broken down due to poverty or due to the intensity of so many religions coming together at one single point is thanks to Mahatma Gandhi's gift of obtaining of freedom through non-violence. Now, when we recognize and awaken to whom we are, we understand the law of dharma and the law of karma. The law of karma is whom we are is the sum total of our past, and whom we can be is from the moment now, what I think, so be. The law of dharma is whatever we do, we would like to be at the receiving end of grace. When we say receiving end of grace, it means we know how to align ourselves to more of consciousness and deploy tools of consciousness. For instance, when we do our yoga, we would like to utilize our yoga to enhance consciousness and tap into the greater consciousness through each asana, tap into the greater consciousness through our yogic process itself. And we now understand every thought can be evaluated for the dharma inside it. We do not simply do things for the sake of doing things. We do it in the flow. We allow the flow to be, and this flow is always guiding us. We understand dharma from different layers. We understand that you feed people. We are now awakening the energies of grace of the body element that we are in. In other words, to feed and feed and feed the hungry, there is an energy flow happening that basically is evolving us. Likewise, any dharma activity, anything good that we do is an energy field that we are awakening. In other words, there is the push of daily effort, a daily sadhana, a daily inner journey. And then there's the pull of being good, doing good, thinking good. Now, there is a beautiful grace that flows, lifting us higher and higher, and our flying becomes gliding. What was so beautiful, as my own personal experiences was, The more deeper I went, the more I felt like a bird that could be fed, that would be fed no matter what. It just felt protective, that I was taken care of. This in reality is Mother Kundalini taking care of us. When the fire, inner fire awakens and grows and grows and grows and grows, it's like a hood of a cobra looking after us. We are innocent. In all our innocence, all we seek is the higher conscious mind and the higher conscious thought. And in between all this is the karmic circumstances where we are that needs to be taken care of. Sometimes we may say, hey, I pray so much, why is my life filled with so much suffering? And then you look back 10 years back and you ask yourself, did you not pray 10 years ago? And if you were granted all those wishes, are you sure you would be happy today? Maybe, maybe not. But one thing we can be certain is, when we are in the flow of doing what we have to do as from the heart, it does not matter, results do not matter. We know we are inspired beings, and we know that when we bring our focus of timelessness into time, there is genius of what we do. We attain mastery of these geniuses by understanding that there is a state of joy from each breath. And each breath in awareness allows us to climb higher in thought, to derive the most potent thought that defines our reality. From here, as we journey into our own expansive beingness, we understand how to utilize consciousness. For instance, if there's something we really badly seek, we understand that that seeking really is not for ourselves, it is for all of humanity. So when we pray for all of humanity, we are opening a much more powerful channel of energy to flow through us. So as the instruments of the divine, we are allowing source to flow through us, and any thought that we have is naturally manifested. Now, it is only natural that when we wake up and when we go deeper into ourselves, into our states of joy, and bringing, condensing our mind into one, that siddhis, extra normal potencies, wake up. Most sages would say, be careful in even entertaining that extra power. What if you did utilize that extra power to enhance your own states of consciousness? For instance, out-of-body experiences, leaving the body and taking a journey. How about utilizing this siddhi to leave your body and go to all the shrines of worship and go into the sanctum sanctorum of each shrine and say your mantra there every day and then come back to your body? This is how we utilize a siddhi to enhance siddhis. But would we ever want to utilize this in the normal human realities? We would not want to, because we have surrendered ourselves to the highest potency of power. What use is anything that is temporary? We would want to utilize these states of joy to enable a clearer vision from the knowing. So as you climb up, the lotus as a blossom blossoms above. This is called the Sahasrara, the thousand petals of a lotus. Once the petals open, there's no coming back. every step we take forward is the gift of thousands of lifetimes coming to be blessings for us. Not a step is wasted. It might seem we have wasted a few steps. Yes, it might be, but we are able to condense several lifetimes of learning into wisdom, and we are able to transform our life utilizing the genius of knowing. So the genius of knowing works together with all the five senses that we have, and it creates the sixth sense, and the sixth sense is why we worship the six-pointed star, Lord Murga, the guru to all the gurus. That guru is our own states of consciousness. This state of consciousness flows like a river into the ocean. It begins as a stream, as a seeker, slowly becomes a river, simply flowing and enjoying the flow. And then once it is the ocean, every thought wave is like a wave that moves. We are aware of it, but every thought we know is grace. So divine beings, today's beautiful journey together, as in the talks of empowering transformation. First, open your heart chakra and allow the grace to be. When we say our teachings are experiential, it necessarily means that you and I here are connecting as one to be this states of joy. So let's recite the mantra Rama 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 Rama. This is the mantra of Mahatma Gandhi. This is the mantra of Kabir and so many beautiful beings. This is the mantra where a thief who obtained this mantra sat meditating on it until an anthill grew over him, and years later when he came out, he was Valmiki, the sage who wrote the Ramayana. So when you say Rama 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 Rama, imagine that we are infinity in three forms. Infinity is the lingam, and the lingam in three forms. The first form of infinity is the sky and beyond and beyond and beyond, infinite, 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 infinite. The next is the infinity that we are enshrined in this body. And then is the heart chakra. So when you are saying this mantra, imagine, or rather experience the I am experience of who I am. I am who I am, saying the mantra. Understand that you are the observer behind saying the mantra itself. So let's say Rama 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 and connect to the infinity that we are. Rama 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 Rama. Feel the divine as in the form of our body, as enshrined in our body. Rama 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 Rama. Come into the heart chakra. When you come into the heart chakra, when you're meditating, ask, who am I? And take yourself to the I am experience of the heart chakra and condense all that is into the soul energy that you are. Rama 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 Receive the blessings of the journey, receive the blessings of our coming together into the single pointed focus of whom we are, and receive the blessings. Divine beings, I am happy to be here with each one of us today, so we can come together as conscious beings, lit, awake, experiencing a magnificent reality that we define through the knowing is the power to be inspired. The greatest of all the energies that we could ever experience is knowing and the power of inspiration and the grace to flow, to enact, enable, and simply do. All this comes from being. The being is consciousness. The beingness is our daily journey through every breath to be the breath beyond breath. We are the innermost fire called tapas. Tapas is the fire that we have perpetually going on inside ourselves. We are constantly expanding and expanding and expanding ourselves to being the vastness of infinity. From here, every thought comes from the full moon-like moment. This is the full moon. It comes from the full moon-like being. The moon-like being that our mind has become. When the mind climbs up above, when our awareness climbs up above the mind, our ability to draw thoughts from a moon-like mind is only the sacred flow, this flow that we are, the flow of oneness, the flow of grace. Grateful to each of you, each of us being here, as blessings of ancient grace in the now, as joys shared with us, celebrating consciousness as one. Gratitude. Namaste.